Shock, I just wanted to say that I'm going to keep time, if that's okay. Unless there's someone else that's already keeping time. It's probably because the fan is blowing on me right now. Hold on. That should be better. Okay, yeah, I was just wanting to say that I was going to keep time as long as no one else was doing it. So, yeah.
Let me get my clock ready. Okay, ready, go. Guys, thanks for being here. Steve, thanks for being here. I got a lot to cover. So, as you guys know, as we all know, atheists have tried for centuries to disprove the existence of God, but nobody has ever been able to do it. So rather than me attack straw men at this point, I'll just wait for Steve's response to this question. What good reasons are there to think that God does not exist? Now, in tonight's debate, I'm going to defend two basic contentions. First, there are good reasons to think that God exists, and two, there are no good reasons to think that atheism is true. Now, I'll leave it up to Steve to present his arguments for atheism before I respond to them. But in my opening speech, I want to sketch some lines of evidence in favor of God's existence. As an ex-atheist myself, now Christian, I know that God makes sense of a wide range of the data of human experience, including philosophical, scientific, moral, and historical considerations. Let's start with the origin of the universe. Have you guys ever asked yourself where the universe came from? Did it have a beginning, or does it just go back and back forever? Typically, atheists have said that the universe is just eternal and uncaused, but there are good reasons, both philosophically and scientific, which call into question that assumption. Philosophically, the idea of the infinite past is very problematic. If the universe never had a beginning, that means that the number of past events in the history of the universe is infinite. But the real existence of an actually infinite number of things leads to metaphysical absurdities. For example, here's an example of the absurdity of an infinite past. Take the planets Jupiter and Saturn. Suppose that for every orbit that Saturn completes around the Sun, the planet Jupiter completes two. If Saturn has completed 10 orbits, Jupiter has completed 20. If Saturn has completed a trillion, Jupiter has completed 2 trillion. The longer they orbit, the farther Saturn falls behind. If they continue to orbit forever, they will approach a limit at which Saturn is infinitely far behind Jupiter. But now turn the story around. Suppose Jupiter and Saturn have been orbiting the Sun from eternity past. Now which one will have completed the most orbits? Well, the correct mathematical answer is that the number of their orbits is identical, but that seems absurd. For the longer they orbit, the greater the disparity between them grows. So how does the number of their orbits magically become identical simply by making them orbit from eternity past? These and many other examples suggest that infinity is just an idea in your mind, not something that exists in reality. But that entails that since past events are not just ideas but are real, the number of past events must be finite. Therefore, the series of past events cannot go back and back forever. Rather, the universe must have begun to exist. But then the inevitable question arises, why did the universe come into being? What brought the universe into existence? Some intrepid atheists have asserted that the universe just popped into being without a cause. But surely that's metaphysically impossible. For such a conclusion is, in the words of philosopher of science Bernulf Kandersteiner, quote, in head-on collision with the most successful ontological commitment in the history of science, namely the metaphysical principle that out of nothing, nothing comes. So why does the universe exist instead of just nothing? Where did it come from? There must have been a transcendent cause which brought the universe into being. We can summarize our argument thus far as follows. One, the universe began to exist. Two, if the universe began to exist and the universe has a transcendent cause, and three, therefore the universe has a transcendent cause. Given the truth of the two premises, the conclusion necessarily follows. Now, from the very nature of the case, this cause must be an uncaused, changeless, timeless, and immaterial being which created the universe. It must be uncaused because we've seen that there cannot be an infinite regress of causes. It must be timeless and therefore changeless, at least without the universe, because it created time. Because it also created space, it must transcend space as well and therefore be immaterial, not physical. Now, there are only two possible candidates that could fit such a description, either an abstract object like a number or an unembodied mind or consciousness. But abstract objects don't stand in causal relations. For example, the number 7 can't cause anything. Therefore, it follows that the transcendent cause of the universe is an unembodied mind. And thus we are brought not merely to an uncaused cause of the universe, but to its personal creator. Let's go to objective moral values and duties. Our first argument gives us a transcendent personal creator of the universe, but it doesn't tell us anything about his moral character. So how can we know that he is good? My second argument addresses that question. If God did not exist, objective moral values and duties would not exist. And by objective moral values, I mean values which are valid and binding whether people believe in them or not. Many theists and atheists agree that if God does not exist, then moral values and duties are not objective in this sense. For example, Michael Ruse, he's an agnostic philosopher of science. He says that morality is just an aid to survival and reproduction, and any deeper meaning is illusory. The problem, though, is on a naturalistic atheist view, moral values are just the byproduct of biological evolution and social conditioning. Just like a troop of baboons exhibits cooperative, even self-sacrificial behavior because natural selection has determined it to be advantageous in the struggle for survival, so their primate cousins, atheists will say, have developed similar behavior for this same reason. As a result of socio-biological pressures, atheists will say there has emerged among Homo sapiens a sort of herd, H-E-R-D, herd morality, which functions well in the perpetuation of our species. The problem on atheism, though, is on the atheistic view, there doesn't seem to be anything about this morality that makes it objectively binding and true. Certain actions, such as rape, atheists will tell us they may not be socially advantageous, and so in the course of human development, it has become taboo. But that does absolutely nothing to show that rape is wrong. Such behavior goes on all the time in the animal kingdom. And given atheism, the rapist who chooses to flout the herd morality is doing nothing more serious than acting unfashionably, sort of the moral equivalent of a man that chooses to wear white socks with the tuxedo. He's simply out of step with the herd. But that leads to our second premise. Two, objective moral values and duties do exist, and in moral experience we apprehend a realm of moral values and duties that impose themselves upon us. As philosopher Louise Anthony, and she's an atheist, she admits that objective moral values exist. She said, any argument for moral skepticism is going to depend upon premises which are less obvious than the reality of objective moral values themselves. Now, I was gratified to see that Steve, the guy I'm debating, he agrees with me with objective moral values. He affirms the existence of objective moral values. On his video on the moral argument, he says, and I quote you, Steve, people know murder is wrong. Steve also says in that video, it's really, really wrong. Steve's right. Objective moral values exist. Actions like rape, cruelty, racial hatred, and child abuse aren't just socially unacceptable behavior, they're truly evil. Michael Ruse also agrees. He says the man who says it's morally acceptable to rape is just as mistaken as the man who says 2 plus 2 equals 5, Lawrence Krauss. Some things at least are truly evil. But if that is the case, then it follows logically and inescapably that therefore God exists. Now, some people think that evil in the world provides overwhelming evidence against the existence of God. I think the exact opposite is true. Real evil in the world serves to prove the existence of God, since without God to ground objective moral values, good and evil as such would not exist. Let's talk about Jesus Christ. The historical facts concerning Jesus. Our case so far gives us a generic monotheism affirmed by Jews, Christians, and Muslims alike. But do we know anything more about who this God is? Well, to answer that question, we have to look at the person of Jesus of Nazareth. The historical person, Jesus of Nazareth, was by all accounts a remarkable individual. And historians have reached something of a consensus that Jesus did come onto the scene with an unprecedented sense of divine authority. He had the authority to stand and speak in God's place. He claimed that in himself the kingdom of God had arrived, and as visible demonstrations of this fact, he carried out a ministry of miracle working and exorcisms. But the supreme confirmation of his claim was his resurrection from the dead. Now, most people may think that the resurrection of Jesus is something you just believe in by faith or not, but I'm going to go through three facts that are actually recognized by the majority of New Testament historians today, which I believe are best explained by the resurrection of Jesus. Fact one, on separate occasions, different individuals and groups saw appearances of Jesus alive after his death. Fact two, on the Sunday after his crucifixion, Jesus' tomb was found empty by a group of his women followers. And fact three, the original disciples suddenly came to believe in the resurrection of Jesus despite having every predisposition to the contrary. This is why N.T. Wright, who's an eminent New Testament scholar, concludes, quote, "That is why, as a historian, I cannot explain the rise of early Christianity unless Jesus rose again, leaving an empty tomb behind him." So the Christian has rational reasons to believe this, and also attempts to explain away these three great facts, like, well, the disciples stole the body, or Jesus wasn't really dead. Guys, they've all been universally rejected by contemporary scholarship. The simple fact is there's just no plausible naturalistic explanation of these facts, and therefore it seems to me the Christian is justified in believing that the best explanation of the evidence is that Jesus rose from the dead and was who he claimed to be, but that also entails that the God revealed by Jesus of Nazareth exists. And thus we have a good inductive argument for the existence of God based on the resurrection of Jesus. Christians also experience God within their lives. Unless Steve can provide a defeater, which shows that Christians are just deluded, we are rational and honest to believe in our experience. This is experiential reality. Let's go to the fine-tuning, the teleological argument. God makes sense of the complex order in the universe, and during the last 30 years, scientists have been, what's the word I'm looking for, shocked to discover that the existence of intelligent life depends upon a delicate and complex balance of initial conditions simply given at the creation of the universe. And we now know that life-prohibiting universes are vastly more probable than any life-permitting universe like ours. How much more probable? Well, the answer, guys, is that the chances that the universe should be life-permitting are so infinitesimal as to be incomprehensible and incalculable. This is going to blow your minds, guys. Check this out. This is why atheism is now on the decline worldwide, why Christianity is still growing. PCW Davies has calculated that the odds against the initial conditions being suitable for star formation, which you guys know without that planets could not exist, is 1 followed by 1,000,000,000,000,000 zeros at least. Clearly, this is not due to dumb luck and chance. He also estimates that a change in the strength of gravity or the weak force by only, you sitting down, guys, by only one part in 10 raised to the 100th power, that would have prevented a life-permitting universe. The problem is this clearly isn't due to dumb luck or chance because there's not just 1, 2, 5, 10 of these constants and quantities. There's about 50 of these life-permitting constants and quantities which not only must be fine-tuned in this way if this universe is to permit life, but also the quantity is fine-tuned and their ratios to each other must also be exquisitely fine-tuned. Clearly, this is not due to dumb luck and chance, because improbability is now multiplied by improbability until you realize dumb luck and chance is not the rational reason. Well, what about a physical reason? The problem is there's also no physical reason why these constants and quantities should possess the values they do. The one-time agnostic physicist PCW Davies comments, quote, he says, "Through my scientific work, I have come to believe more and more strongly that the physical universe is put together with an ingenuity so astonishing that I cannot accept it merely as a brute fact." Similarly, Fred Hoyle remarks, quote, "A common sense interpretation of the facts suggests that a super intellect has monkeyed with physics." Robert Jastrow, the head of NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies, calls this the most powerful evidence for the existence of God ever to come out of science. And so the Christian is rationally justified in believing in this evidence. And once again, the view that Christian theists have always held, that there is an intelligent designer of the universe, obviously makes much more sense than the stupid atheistic interpretation that the universe just popped into being uncaused out of nothing for no reason and no purpose and just happened to be, by dumb luck and chance, fine-tuned for intelligent life with an incomprehensible precision and delicacy? Right. Can you see why atheism's on the decline worldwide? Let's go to the ontological argument. The ontological argument is epic. It goes like this. It is possible that a maximally great being exists. If it is possible that a maximally great being exists, then a maximally great being exists in some possible world. If a maximally great being exists in some possible world, then it exists in every possible world. 4, if a maximally great being exists in every possible world, then it exists in the actual world. 5. Therefore, a maximally great being exists in the actual world. 6. Therefore, a maximally great being exists. 7. Therefore, God exists. Let's go to the argument for contingency. Everything that exists has an explanation of its existence, either in the necessity of its own nature or in an external cause. If the universe has an explanation of its existence, that explanation is God. 3. The universe exists. Now, what follows logically from these premises, from 1 and 3, it logically follows that, 4, the universe has an explanation of its existence. And from 2 and 4, the conclusion logically follows, therefore, the explanation of the universe existence is God. Now, we covered those arguments. We also have prophecy. There's prophecies that have come true. If you go to www.shotgunowl.net, you can click prophecy and you can read about them, the odds of which they're not due to dumb luck or chance. This is another reason why Christians are rational to believe God exists. For example, Israel was prophesied to be gathered again to herself, and in 1948, this happened. This has not happened with any other nation in world history. Look at the prophecy of Isaiah 53. I challenge people to read Isaiah 53, which clearly is speaking about Jesus Christ. Evolution goes against atheism. Where are these millions upon millions of transitional fossils that we were promised? I was debating an atheist once, and he said the creationists are buying them all up and hiding them. Come on, guys, you know that's not true. Lack of proof and evidence is not evidence. We're missing millions upon millions of transitional fossils showing that atheism and this macroevolution clearly has major problems and is not true. What about ghosts? Demonic activity. There are people in this room. We got 50 people in this room. I bet every single one of you knows someone that has experience with demonic activity or ghosts. My dad was actually attacked by one. We have experience of this. This is not an argument for atheist naturalism. There's something more than naturalism in the world. And I met a guy and a gal in this room once, and they're a husband and wife. They do paranormal investigation in houses, and she said that she clearly does believe that these are evil. She says some of them are definitely evil. Speaking of evil, look at the evils of atheism. Atheism is responsible for over 150 million brutal murders and rapes and genocide under the evil atheist regimes of Stalin, Pol Pot, Kim Jong-il, the Khmer Rouge, and more. Steve, my opponent, would agree what those atheists did was evil. It also leads to a high rate of suicide. Atheists have one of the highest rate of suicide in the world. You don't kill yourself because you're happy. The Amazing Atheist, the number one most subscribed to atheist agnostic, he says he's an atheist agnostic now, which means he's unsure about his atheism. Listen what he said about atheism. He said, quote, "Atheism has no answers." I believe he was right. Atheism has no objective purpose in life. Richard Dawkins said, your sole purpose as an atheist, your sole purpose in life is to propagate DNA. He said, there is no purpose to life. No wonder atheists are killing themselves in record numbers. You could say we should create a bumper sticker that says, friends don't let friends stay atheist. Near-death experiences also goes against atheism and naturalism. Documented proof and evidence of near-death experiences where people can go outside their body, see things, and hear things. Their brain didn't walk down the hospital room and go up 5 steps. Near-death experiences is empirical damage against atheist naturalism. What about mind-body dualism? When you are happy, your brain's not happy. You are happy. Guys, when you are sad, your brain's not sad. You are sad. There's a difference between your mind and your brain. You, everyone in this room, all 50 of us, you chose to come into this room. Your brain just didn't walk you in here. You're not an atheist flesh machine, like my friend Paulo said. You have a mind. This also goes against the belief that everything is just a natural world. Another problem I have with atheism, see, when I was an atheist, my atheist friends were saying it's possible for God to exist. This, and they were also saying it's impossible. When you read Scripture, Scripture clearly says God exists. What we hear coming out of the atheist camp is it's possible and impossible for God to exist. I would like to know from Steve, too, when he gets on the mic, does he believe it's impossible for the Christian God to exist? And if so, what's his arguments against it? Also, argument number 17, archaeological proof of the Bible. Do you know all archaeological proof shows that the Bible is true? There's never been any archaeological a discovery that goes against the Bible. I believe G.K. Chesterton was right when he said, if there were no God, there would be no atheist. Now, how long have I been? All right, I'm almost wrapped up. Listen, guys, in summary tonight, I presented 17 arguments on my side of the debate. If Steve wants us to believe otherwise, that God doesn't exist and that atheism is true, Steve, you must first tear down all 17 of these arguments that I presented and then in their place erect a case of your own to prove that God does not exist. Unless and until he does that, I think that theism is the more plausible worldview. And thanks for listening. All right, Steve, you're up.
Thank you, Jacques. That was very impressive, and you covered a lot of ground, so I'm going to try to cover as much as I can responding to you and also give a few of my own thoughts. I want to start with where you ended, Jacques. You asked if I can offer any arguments against Christian theism and for my atheism, and this is a question that you put to atheists a lot. And to be fair, it is, especially the way you phrase it, a very difficult question to answer. And I think part of that difficulty comes in a disagreement of what atheism is. To me, as an atheist, I explain my atheism this way. My atheism is a position that it is more likely than not that gods do not exist. It is not my way of saying that God definitely does not exist. As you said, Jacques, you asked, am I going to say that the existence of the Christian God is impossible? No, that is not my position. My position is not that that the God of Christianity cannot possibly exist. My position is that given the evidence that we have, given what we know or what we think we know, what we have very good reasons to think we know about how the universe works, it is not very likely that the Christian God exists. And based on that knowledge, the godless universe is the more likely universe, and therefore I call myself an atheist. Let's examine some of your arguments. I'll do the best I can to cover as many of them in my time as I can. The argument from first cause, the argument that because the universe exists, therefore it began to exist, therefore, it had a cause. You and Dr. Craig, who also popularized this argument, like to cite the Big Bang. And the Big Bang model does hold that the universe as we experience it had a definite beginning. The problem is that the Big Bang model also states that prior to this beginning point, time as we know it did not exist. Time and space emerged from the Big Bang just as much as matter and energy emerged from the Big Bang. So when you look at it that way, it really doesn't make sense to think of an infinite regression of events. It doesn't follow that prior to the Big Bang there was an impossible infinity, because literally nothing happened before the Big Bang. The Big Bang emerged from a singularity. We know very little about it. We know almost nothing about where it could have come from, although there are scientific theories that postulate where the singularity could have come from that do not require the assumption of the existence of a God to explain it. But before the singularity began to expand in the Big Bang, there literally was no space and time. So that problem of an infinite number of events is completely eliminated. As to this cause of the beginning of the universe, Schock, you argued that this cause must be uncaused because it is, in fact, the cause of everything. It must be changeless because it created a changing universe, and timeless because it must therefore be outside of time, which it also created, and it must be immaterial because it created matter. It must be personal because the only abstract concept that can create things is a personal mind, therefore a personal gun. To me, the first four claims are baseless assertions. They sound good, but it seems obvious to me, and I'm sure that Chuck will refute this, but you need not be uncaused to cause something. You need not be beyond change in order to create something that undergoes change. A cause need not be outside of time ultimately to have been responsible for time as we experience it. And something that creates matter and that creates material must not be immaterial in and of itself. You can't just simply observe what the fundamental aspects of our universe are and then argue that whatever caused these aspects to exist must therefore be separate and beyond all possible concepts of those aspects. I mean, you can make that argument, and you have, but I don't find it very compelling. And then the last claim in that argument, that the cause must be personal. Dr. Craig and you say that it must be a personal God because of the personal mind, the immaterial personal mind. And you came back to this toward the end of your presentation when you mentioned that when we are happy, we are happy. Our brains aren't happy. You suggest that the mind is separate from the brain, mind-body duality. I find this kind of stunning because it's very well established that our minds are the products of our brains, that even though we do not yet understand everything about human consciousness, about how it works, about what generates it, we know, we have it very well pinned down that it is at the root of physiological phenomenon, that our minds are the products of our brains. Our minds are not immaterial. And since our minds, and arguably the minds of other animals on this planet, are the only minds we have ever observed to exist, it doesn't make much sense to me to say that the mind is immaterial. You mentioned the long shot odds of the universe existing in such a way to allow our existence. And I want to address that, because very often when Christians talk about, when they try to characterize the odds of the universe coming out like this and the universal constants having values such that things like stars are able to exist, and as you said, the light and the heat from stars, particularly the sun, is what allows plants to exist and other forms of life. You talk about these as though these are random processes, as though the universe just sort of shook out like this, and it could have come out any other way. We don't know that that's true. We don't know that actually these universal constants could have had other values. We can theorize, we can hypothesize and say, well, if the electromagnetic force was a little stronger or a little weaker, then chemical bonds would be of a different strength, and we're not sure if atoms or molecules would be able to form in the way that they form, and we're not sure if life would be able to exist. We're not sure if stellar fusion would be possible. We can theorize about how things would be different if the universal constants were not their actual values, but we can't be sure that it's even possible for those universal constants to have values other than the values that they have. It's entirely possible that the universe is the way it is because it simply has to be this way. Related to this argument is the idea that these universal constants have been arranged to these values in order to fine-tune the universe, not just for things like stars and galaxies, but specifically for us, that the universe is fine-tuned for our own existence. I think that this view looks at it backwards. I think a much more plausible explanation for what I would call the apparent fine-tuning of the universe is not that the universe is made to suit us, but that we have evolved, and not just us as human beings, but planets and stars and every other form of matter, every other object that exists in this universe has arisen to be fine-tuned, quote-unquote, for it. In other words, we find objects that exist in this universe that are capable of existing in this universe. I made a video about this a while ago, a year ago or so, And I use the example of a stick insect. A stick insect is so perfectly suited to its natural environment. When it crawls on the trunk of a tree and it holds still, it really looks like a twig. It might be possible, if you didn't have knowledge of evolution or if you didn't accept evolution, to say, well, look there, that stick insect has obviously been made precisely to live in that environment, or that the environment has been fine-tuned for the stick insect. And actually, it's that the stick insect has evolved to fill a particular niche in that environment. The organism has suited itself through evolution to the environment, not the other way around. If the stick insect were dropped into the water in the deep sea next to a hydrothermal vent, it would not fare nearly as well. And just in the same way, if a human being were dropped into the vacuum of space, it would not fare very well in the supposedly fine-tuned universe for us, where only a tiny fraction of it is habitable. What else did you cover here? The moral argument. I want to get to that before my time runs out. You say that morality, that absolute morality, absolute standards of morality clearly exist. And you quoted a video that I made about the moral argument where I said that absolute moral standards do exist. What I was saying there is that it is certainly possible to assert that absolute moral standards exist without also asserting that a God must exist. Personally, and I believe I covered this in the video, and if I didn't, I'm not trying to say I didn't say anything that you quote me as saying, but I personally believe that morality is a man-made phenomenon, and that morality is the product of ourselves as individuals and of our societies as a whole, and that it evolves according to a moral consensus that is constantly changing. And I think this is actually a good thing. I think that the fact that that we define our own morality is what allows morality to evolve and to grow and to allow things like the abolition of slavery. If morality never evolved, if morality was never allowed to move beyond a set point, then moral shortcomings, or things that we now consider moral shortcomings, could never be corrected. The evolution of morality is a necessary thing to the improvement of society and to the improvement of ourselves, so that we can continue to strive to make better and freer and safer and more humane human societies. But let's, for the sake of argument, say that there were absolute moral values. It seems to me that you can't have it both ways. You can either have Right, sorry. Someone private messaged me. It kicked me off. Anyway, the evidence for Jesus of Nazareth. It seems to me that the evidence for the life of Jesus has been overstated here a bit. I am not one who. I was talking about the moral aspects. I'll get back to that in a second. It seems to me that the evidence for Jesus has been overstated a bit. I am not one who argues that Jesus never existed. I am not one who argues that there never was a Jesus. I take sort of the middle road and say that there probably was a historical Jesus, but he probably was very little, had very little in common with the figure that we read about in the New Testament. Jesus is the product of legend and myth. In my estimation, I know that a lot of Christian apologists argue that can't be possible because they date the gospel stories to so soon a period after Jesus' life that it would have been impossible for these sorts of legends about his resurrection and his post-resurrection appearances to have been created. But this has been proven to be false, and it's actually based on a misreading of a book, and it seems to me that so much of Christian apologetics rests right on this argument that it just isn't possible that the stories that we read about Jesus in the Gospels were the product of exaggeration or invention or myth making, and I just see no reason to believe that. You talk about the evidence of the empty tomb. There actually you say there's archaeological evidence because there's no archaeological evidence to contradict the Bible. I would argue that geochronology contradicts the Bible, at least a literal version of the Bible, quite definitively. The evidence, there is no definitive scientific evidence for a worldwide flood, as in the flood of Noah. That also would contradict the Bible. Just two examples off the top of my head. But as far as there is no archaeological evidence, no positive evidence for the life of Jesus at all. Now, again, I don't argue that Jesus never lived, but you can't argue that there is positive archaeological evidence for Jesus. And there certainly is no reason to believe that there was an empty tomb, that no empty tomb has ever been discovered. And even if there were the discovery of Jesus' empty tomb today, 2,000 years later, it would prove absolutely nothing. So the arguments that we should just read the Bible and read the New Testament uncritically, to me, just don't make a whole lot of sense. I don't see that that is a warranted assumption for us to make. I think there is some history in the New Testament. I think there is some legitimate history to be gleaned from it, but we have to read it critically. We can't just read it and say, oh, well, it's obviously all true because of this and this and this and this. We have to read it critically. Let me go back to the moral argument very quickly because that was where I was when I was cut off the mic. Someone asked, why is rape wrong? Well, again, if there are objective moral standards, which I said don't need a God to exist, and in fact can't exist if they're defined by God, if there is an objective moral standard, then rape is wrong because rape is wrong. If, as I believe, morality is defined by us, then rape is wrong because we say it's wrong. And to me, that is enough. And not only is that enough, that's good. That means that we have decided. We have asked ourselves a moral question, and we have answered it for ourselves. Not just my morality, but our morality as a whole, as a species, with very, very few exceptions. We have decided ourselves that this is wrong. And to me, this carries much more weight and has much more meaning than to simply say that rape is wrong because God says it's wrong. That to me is not a moral code. That is following orders. If you can decide for yourself that rape is wrong, or that murder is wrong, or that stealing from someone is wrong, and you can think of a real reason why this act, whatever it is wrong, then you don't need to appeal to God. You have created a moral standard much more powerful than anything that could be handed down to you from a divine authority. Let me see what else. You mentioned transitional fossils. Where are the transitional fossils? All fossils are transitional fossils. This is a misunderstanding of how evolution works. The only way a fossil would not be a transitional fossil is if it is an evolutionary dead end. If a species leaves an ancestor species that lived in a later epoch than that species, then it is a transitional fossil. If there is a descendant species from humanity at some point in the distant future, if humanity is not the last line in our evolutionary history, then we someday will be transitional fossils. Every fossil is potentially a transitional fossil. Finally, let me just, how much time do I have left? 3 minutes? Okay, 2 minutes. Okay, thank you, Jonathan. Let me just say, as Christopher Hitchens said, we don't have bodies, we are bodies. And I like to say, we don't just live in the universe, we are of the universe. We are part of this place, and we are part of it in a way that we would not be if we were simply created and magically planted here by a God. And that in and of itself is just a preference of mine. That is not necessarily evidence that that is true. Just as Schock's preference that there be absolute moral standards is not evidence that absolute moral standards exist. Just that Schock's preference that the universe be the product of his particular theistic God, he would clearly prefer that, but that does not mean that that is in fact the case. Atheism, to me, because it is the most likely scenario. Occam's razor advises us to reject any explanation that requires too many assumptions. And to me, the main reason why I'm an atheist, the main reason why atheism makes the most sense to me, is because God given what we see in the universe, given what we know, or at least what we think we know at this point about the universe, gods are an unnecessary assumption. Everything works without that assumption. And I think I'll just go ahead and wrap up there. Thank you, Shock, and I look forward to hearing your next presentation.
All right. Okay, you ready? Now, what is it? I got 10 minutes? Right? 10 minutes? Not you, Penguin. Yeah, remember, Mega, when you got on, when Steve got instant message, I was on the mic and you bumped me off. But that's okay, man. Okay, ready? Go. We haven't heard any arguments for why we should believe atheism is true. Steve now concedes that the Christian God can exist. Listen, on objective morality, he believes it just comes from evolution and stuff like that. But here's the problem. Think about this, guys. All the abstract objects, like greed, hatred, cruelty, selfishness, think about this. What obligates me to align my life with one of set of those abstractions rather than with a different set of abstractions on atheism? Why am I morally obligated to align my lifestyle with loyalty, compassion, fairness, and so forth, rather than greed, selfishness, cruelty, and so forth? It seems to me on atheism there isn't any basis whatsoever for moral duty or moral obligation on this point of view. But the person that has God can make sense of moral obligations because we believe that our moral duties are constituted by God's commands. You shall love your neighbor as yourself, for example. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. And in virtue of these divine commandments, we have moral duties and obligations to live in a certain way. But in the absence of any divine commandment, in the absence of any divine lawgiver, I just don't see why we would have any moral obligation or moral duty on atheism, as atheism lacks a foundation for them. It is fantastically improbable. Listen to me, guys. Think about how stupid atheism is. It is fantastically improbable that just those sort of creatures would emerge from a blind evolutionary process that would just by dumb luck and chance correspond to these abstractly existing moral values and principles. If you guys go to Steve's channel, he says right there, Steve, I'm quoting you, you said, people know murder is wrong. I agree with that. You said it's really, really wrong. Steve affirms objective morals. When you go see his video, unless he's contradicting himself here, Steve, you affirm objective moral values. The problem, though, is you want to say that they come from evolution. I just don't buy it. I don't see why we would have any moral obligation or moral duty on atheism, as atheism lacks a foundation for them. And even, Steve, you believe you're just an atheist flesh machine. You don't believe you have a soul or a spirit or anything like that. And after all, rape and all this other type of stuff happens in the animal kingdom all the time. So it is fantastically improbable that coincidentally just those sort of creatures would emerge from a blind evolutionary process that would then correspond to these abstractly existing moral values and principles. I mean, think about it. This is absolutely incredible that atheists want us to believe that this blind, naturalistic evolutionary process should produce just that type of creature that is in line with objective moral values like fairness, love, goodness, kindness, and so forth. This is really totally, totally impossible. The atheists want us to believe that the moral realm knew these creatures were coming. That's ridiculous. But of course it cannot know on an atheistic view. But by contrast, on the view that God exists, listen guys, both the moral realm and the natural realm are under the sovereignty of God. So that God can develop just those sort of creatures which will correspond to objectively moral values and duties and so forth. The moral realm and the natural realm are both under the sovereignty of God. Now, someone might say, well, wait a minute, Shock, couldn't we learn about objective values through society and our parents? Of course we can. I have no problem with us coming to learn objective values. Steve, I think you're confused, man. What you're involved with really isn't atheism, it's faithism. You have not provided any good arguments of why I should believe atheism is true. We've heard a lot of bluster, but I haven't heard any good arguments. It's not atheism, it's faithism, folks. See, on atheism, the natural realm and the moral realm fall apart. They're independent of each other, and therefore it would be impossible that these two realms, by dumb luck and chance, just happen to mesh all these objective moral values through the blind evolutionary process, that type of creature to whom these moral values and duties would correspond and be applicable. So I'm sorry, I just cannot buy into the madness of atheism. I am very much persuaded that atheism just doesn't make sense at all. It is madness in its purest form. I think, Steve, what you're confusing is moral ontology, which is the existence of moral values, which you admit murder is wrong. Steve, I guess you're going to go change your video now and say, well, murder isn't always wrong, or rape isn't always wrong. Look, if you guys agree with me that there's a difference between love and hate, then you agree that objective values exist. Now, I would ask you guys, do you believe that rape is always wrong? Unless Steve wants to justify some instance where rape would be okay, I think every one of us, we have this experiential reality where we know that these things are wrong. Look, who's watching the clock? I have to be honest, I ran and got some coffee, but Steve, I heard what you said, I had the speakers up. I think Joseph Addison was right when he said, to be an atheist requires an indefinitely greater measure of faith than to receive all the great truths which atheism would deny. I just am not convinced. How much time do I have left? I got to say, 3 now or 2 minutes? I got to tell you something, Steve. I got to tell you something. 3 minutes. Steve, check this out. Steve, I think it's quite obvious you haven't been able to prove that atheism is accurate and correct. But you know, we asked the Atheist Experience Show to prove it. They said a pink unicorn in a cardboard box. I wrote down all the stuff that you said. The bizarre thing is you said all the fossils are transitional fossils. Well, that's just totally not true. That's just totally not true. We don't have these transitional fossils. There's a lack of transitional fossils. You know this. Evolutionists admit it. Yeah, so to say that everything is a transitional fossil is stupid, Steve. You know better than this, man. Steve, I got to tell you something. Let me know my time. Steve, I was really embarrassed because my mom went to watch one of your videos. And Steve, she watched your video where you said the 5 stupid things about Jesus. And you know that part at 204 where you got a picture of Jesus and it says, eat a blank, mom? And it rhymes with rock. My mom was like, oh my gosh, this guy's crazy. She goes, this is the guy you're going to... And then you know where you said Jesus is, it rhymes with brick? My mom saw that, Steve. And then you know where you said at 2 minutes and 38 seconds in your own words, you said, Mary should have told the angel to go F himself? My mom saw that, Steve. Then at 2 minutes and 50 seconds, you say, F you, Jesus, and you cuss at Jesus Christ. See, Steve, it's just madness. This is why atheism is declining worldwide. Now, when I get back on the mic, I know we got, the next thing's 5 minutes. Yeah, Steve believes in angels, I guess. Let me know when my time's up, guys. But when I get back on the mic, I'm gonna show you guys actual proof and evidence that atheism is now declining worldwide. And it's because of stupid arguments like this. Steve, please, brother, you're too good for this, man. Leave the madness of atheism while you can. I say you kiss the pink unicorn goodbye, high-five the leprechaun, throw out the spaghetti monster, and... you know, leave the madness of atheism.
What's the video where he curses? That's probably most of them. Let me see. You say that I have failed to prove that atheism is true. I've failed to provide evidence. And I think one of the reasons why we will always have this disagreement is that when we're dealing with a question of theism versus atheism, the sort of evidence that you're talking about doesn't really exist. It's not a mathematical proof. It's evidence and it's argument. And we can have different opinions on this evidence. We can have different opinions on what the evidence is and whether or not a given piece of evidence is compelling and what it compels us to believe, things like this. We will probably always disagree on this, Shock, and I'm okay with that. To me, this is more about the conversation than about trying to convert people. I've enjoyed your presentation so far. I haven't found them convincing myself, just as you can say that I have given you no reason to believe that atheism is true. I can say the same thing of you. I can say you have given me no reason to doubt that atheism is true. You've given me no reason to accept Christianity, that Christianity is true, or that the existence of any God is true. To some of your specific points, you went back to the moral argument, and it seems to me like you are saying, at least at first, you're asserting that to be moral according to the Christian view is to follow the rules that God has laid down, that a given thing is wrong because God has declared that it is wrong, or perhaps because it is in line with God's good nature. I know a lot of Christians believe that. It's not so much that God decrees that something is right or wrong. It's more that if our actions are lined up with God's moral nature, then they're right and wrong. But either way, God himself is the standard. But then I think you demonstrated that practically speaking, that is not the case, because you asked the room if anyone believes if there's ever an instance where rape is not wrong, and you say rape is wrong, and you say that I agree with you, and you're right, I do agree with you. I believe that rape is wrong. I believe that murder is wrong. I think we have defined these particular things as wrong in our society. If an act is not wrong, then it can't be rape, because rape is always wrong. But if rape is wrong because rape is wrong, then whether this is a standard we have created for ourselves or whether it is an absolute objective moral standard, either way, God's opinion or God's nature as the standard is completely irrelevant. If rape is wrong because rape is wrong, then rape is wrong because rape is wrong. We don't need to appeal to God. God does not even need to exist for rape to be wrong, if in fact rape is wrong. So for that reason, that's why I say that morality, the existence of morality, even if we believe in the existence of absolute morality, that does not compel us to believe that there is a God that defines that morality. Because whether we think that morality would be better if it existed under the sovereignty of God is irrelevant if it gives us no reason to believe that that God even exists. You mentioned objective morals coming, that it doesn't make any sense for objective morals to be due to evolution, because why would beings like ourselves have evolved and we would just happen to be suited to these moral standards? Again, I feel like you might not be characterizing evolution quite as accurately as you might. Evolution is a blind process in a sense, in that it doesn't go toward any particular goal. But it's not fair, it's not accurate to call evolution a random process, because it does operate according to laws, the law of natural selection, as well as the laws of physics and chemistry, which often get overlooked. Evolution is very tightly hemmed in by the laws of physics and the laws of chemistry. It can't just go off in any direction it wants. Not that it wants. So if there are objective moral values, if these objective moral standards just happen to be pre-existing, just as the laws of physics are pre-existing and the laws of chemistry, then why is it so strange to expect that when moral beings such as ourselves appear, that we are tied to these moral standards, just as we are tied to the standards of the laws of physics and the laws of chemistry? Why would the laws of morality, if in fact they do exist in that way, be any different? You come back to the fossils, the argument of the transitional fossils. All fossils are potentially transitional fossils. That is just the way evolution works. I'm sorry if you disagree with me on that, but that is the way it is. That is how evolution works. If a species leaves a descendant and that species dies, then the fossils of that species are a transitional fossil. And we can see this in the fossil record. The fossil record is laid out, the geographical distribution of species is laid out precisely as we would expect it if evolution were true. You can go to a natural history museum in any major city in the world. You can go to Washington, D.C., which is right near where I live. I'm sure that out in California there are natural history museums where you can go and you can see fossils in chains of intermediaries from earlier forms to more recent forms that have been established as transitional fossils, as an evolutionary line from an earlier species, an ancestor, all the way up to a more recent species, and perhaps even a modern species. This is not controversial scientifically. The evolution is, within modern biology, is as well accepted as the Big Bang theory is among cosmologists. It simply isn't controversial, except in some of its finer details. You mentioned the pink unicorn in the box. I prefer to use the story from Carl Sagan's book, The Demon-Haunted World, of the invisible dragon that lives in my garage. I think better than the pink unicorn, this is a great example, a great metaphor for the existence of God. Because the existence of God, the claims about God can be tailored to slide around any sort of scientific evidence or any philosophical argument that can be concocted to contradict it, it's really impossible to disprove. It's a non-falsifiable hypothesis. And we know from experience in science that non-falsifiable hypotheses aren't usually really worth pursuing because they don't really explain anything. They can never be proven, therefore they're never really any good, and you can never be disproven. It's just like if I said, as Carl Sagan proposed in The Demon-Haunted World, let's say I said to you that I have an invisible dragon that lives in my garage, and you say to me, well, I can prove that if the dragon is really there, then let me put some flour down on the floor, and if he's really there, then he'll leave footprints. And I say, oh, well, he flies all the time. He wouldn't leave footprints. And then you say, well, I'll put in a thermometer, and when he breathes fire, the heat will spike, and if the heat doesn't spike, then there's no dragon there. And I will say, oh, well, that won't work either, because he breathes special fire that doesn't raise the temperature. I can always come up with special pleading arguments, and I can keep moving the goalposts, so I can eventually get you to the point where you would have to admit, okay, I can't prove that you don't have an invisible dragon that lives in your garage. But does that mean that you should then assume that I do have an invisible dragon that lives in my garage? Of course not. It makes absolutely no sense for you to believe that I have an invisible dragon in my garage. It's a preposterous claim, and it would be silly of you to believe it. And in the same way, for you to say that that not only is there a God that exists, a God, but it is a specific God who is interested in the way we live our lives and in the choices we make and who and how we conduct ourselves with each other in who we choose to love, who we choose to have sex with, things like this. And yet this is an unfalsifiable hypothesis. There is no reason for me to accept that this is true. You said that I believe that I'm just I'm the product of evolution. I'm just a meat machine. And that's an inelegant way to put it, but that's true. That is what I believe. I don't believe that we have a soul in the sense of an eternal, immortal soul, but as Daniel Dennett says, and I think this makes a lot of sense, we do have souls, but they're just made of neurons, and they're just as mortal as the rest of us. And that's it for me. I'm going to wrap up. Thanks a lot for listening.
All right. Hey, before I start, don't start the clock yet. How much time do we got now? Is this our last 5 minutes? This is our last 5 minutes, right, Steve? Steve, you know that dragon you were talking about? I think that dragon has your arguments for atheism, man, because your arguments for atheism is like that invisible dragon. They're non-existent. But that dragon's like your arguments for atheism. I want you guys to notice something. He says all fossils are transitional. Well, where are they, Steve? I want to show you guys something here. I might as well just show you this since I got you guys in the room here. Check this out, Steve, because you can see this. And by the way, Steve, well, you could download this and stuff. I want to show you guys how Steve is absolutely wrong. Think about what he's saying. He's saying everything is a transitional fossil. This is absolutely incorrect. Macroevolution has not been proven. We do not have the millions upon millions of transitional fossils. The only thing that's been proven is micro. We have change within limits. Steve, you know this. You have failed to provide proof and evidence of any of these fossils. Look, what you're talking about is microevolution. Look at this page. Are you guys all on the page, question 9? Look what it says. Why are the expected countless millions of transitional fossils missing? Now, we have collected over a billion fossils. We don't have these transitional fossils. All we have are fossils that show microevolution. Darwin noted the problem, and it still remains. The evolutionary family trees and textbooks are based on imagination, not fossil evidence. Steve, you're wrong. You are wrong. Look what famous Harvard paleontologist, and he's an evolutionist too. He believes in evolution. He said, look, the extreme rarity. Well, wait a minute, guys. Steve, who's right? Steve in the room or Stephen Jay Gould? Was he right? You know what? There's all types of evolutionists that say the extreme rarity of transitional forms in the fossil record persist as the trade secret of paleontology everywhere. Now, was Steve able to show that on atheism, murder is wrong? See, he says murder is wrong. He says rape is wrong in his video. Steve, your videos are just digging you into a deeper hole, man. You really dug yourself into a hole with those videos. See, I did some homework on your videos, and Steve says that murder is wrong. Listen, Steve, on Steve's video on the moral argument, 3 minutes into it, he says people know murder is wrong. This is this experiential reality of this objective moral foundation. That's what Scripture says, that God has put that on our hearts. He even says in that video, it's really, really wrong. Now, Steve, what's interesting is later on in one of Steve's videos, he says Christians are homophobic, bigoted, fundamentalist a-holes. That's what Steve said. Oh, Steve, would we have any doubt what you would do if you were the king of the country to us Christians? We'd probably all be thrown to the lion. Steve, you said in your video, 7 minutes and 35 seconds into it, you said that you believe Christians are homophobic, bigoted, fundamentalist a-holes. And yet you're trying to tell us about morality? Please, dude, you should be ashamed of yourself. Steve, you should be ashamed of yourself, man. Get some class. Get some dignity. We treated you with respect when you came in here, yet you're calling Christians homophobic, bigoted, fundamentalist a-holes? Steve, I'm going to give you a chance to apologize to the Christians in the room. Would you Christians like to hear an apology from Steve? I would. Come on, Steve. You said you're reaching out your hand of friendship to us. We want to hear an apology. Steve, come on. Were we nice to you? So I want, Steve, this is how we're gonna build bridges. You're already wrong on the fossil evidence. This is the time to redeem yourself. So, Steve, I would like to hear you say, yeah, Shock, I'm wrong. Christians are not homophobic, bigoted, fundamentalist a-holes. My mom was really hurt when she saw that part, Steve. So come on, Steve, this is your chance to shine. All right, everyone's on the edge of their seat. Will Steve do the right thing objectively? Go ahead, Steve.
Poor Shock's mom. I want to say at the beginning here, right before I get into my closing statement, I don't believe I ever said all Christians are homophobic a-holes. But if anyone would like to argue that some Christians are not, I would love to entertain that argument. I think I've shown in my conduct here, and I think my conduct when I engage with Christians in general, when we have conversations, that I'm perfectly willing and capable of treating Christians with respect, even though I will admit, and it's not even really that much of an admission, because I don't think it's anything to be ashamed of, that I don't treat Christian beliefs with respect, just as Shock doesn't treat my atheism with respect, and I wouldn't expect him to, because he is not an atheist and I am not a Christian. But because the fact that I am willing to treat Christians with respect, and the fact that I have thoroughly enjoyed this exchange with Shock here, and wish that I could do things like this more often, that doesn't mean that I'm not going to mock Christian beliefs when I feel that it's necessary. And it doesn't mean that I'm going to apologize if I take a tone that at times is offensive to Christians. Of course, Shock's mom was offended by the horrible things I said about Jesus because she's a Christian and she believes in Jesus very much. And it only makes sense that she should be offended by that. But that doesn't mean I'm going to apologize for it. I think that in my time in this chat room tonight and in the visit I made earlier this week, I think I've demonstrated that I'm not an uncivil person. I'm not a classless person, that I do enjoy engagement, that I do enjoy the exchange of ideas, and that I have really enjoyed this debate with Shock. And the debates that I have with Christians in my Facebook page, on my YouTube page, it's something that I absolutely relish, and it's not something I would want to give up. If we say murder is wrong, then murder is wrong. Murder is wrong because we say it's wrong, and that is enough for me. That may not be enough for Shock. That may not be enough for the theists in the room. That is enough for me. If we say murder is wrong, then murder is wrong. Microevolution and macroevolution, the only difference between those is in terms of scale. To say that microevolution that causes an accumulation of beneficial mutations will not lead to macroevolution is just the same as saying that one penny plus one penny equals two pennies, but no matter how many pennies you add, you'll never get to $1 million. It's just a fallacy. It makes no sense. And thanks to Varjak for giving me that for giving me that metaphor a few years ago when we were discussing this. I think it's a really good way to put it. I've really enjoyed this. I think we're going to take questions after this, which I'm looking forward to. Shock, your reputation preceded you for me before this. I think you were mischaracterized by a lot of atheists who warned me not to go through with this. I have not found you to be unfair in the least. I've been treated very well here by the moderators and by you. And I want to wrap up here, as I said earlier, by extending a hand of friendship and saying that I understand why Christians are offended by things I've said. I don't take any of those things back. I stand behind them. I actually think I'm a lot less incendiary than a lot of YouTube atheists. I've really enjoyed this, and I think that we've both conducted ourselves well. We've ended up right where I thought we would. Neither of us has moved the other, but I think it was a really good conversation. And once again, I want to thank you for inviting me, and thank you and your mods for allowing a few of my atheist buddies that I've noticed to come in here and watch and contribute. And I look forward now to the questions. So once again, thanks a lot.
Guys, I went through 17 arguments. He didn't give any arguments. And Steve, I have to tell you, I'm glad that you're real polite, but most atheists are real sweet and syrupy when they come in here. You're not as bold as you are on your videos, man. It's like you came in here with your tail between your legs. Let that be a lesson to your atheist friends. Look, I went through the cosmological argument. He didn't have any response on how the universe began. I went to the fine-tuning argument. He couldn't debunk that. I went to the moral argument. We showed that he doesn't have any reason, any moral foundation for his atheism. In fact, he won't even apologize for calling Christians homophobic, bigoted, fundamentalist a-holes. He won't even apologize. That's the arrogance of atheism. On experiential reality, he wasn't able to debunk experiential reality. On the sixth argument I gave, the ontological argument, he didn't address that. He didn't address experiential reality. On Jesus Christ, he agreed that Jesus Christ existed. Now, I want you guys to listen to this. all eight of those arguments, also the contingency argument and the prophecy argument, all go onto my side of the debate. He didn't give any arguments. He just talked about what I said. Steve, what you have isn't atheism, it's faithism, man. You're an atheist based on faith, not arguments. On evolution, he said, well, everything's a transitional fossil, which we showed you is absolutely wrong. We're missing the transitional fossil. He didn't even address ghost or demonic activity. That goes on my side of the argument. On the evils of atheism, he didn't even talk about that. But why should we expect him to? He won't even apologize for calling Christians homophobic, bigoted, fundamentalist a-holes. On the atheism's high suicide rate, he didn't talk about that. That goes on my side of the debate. On atheism having no objective purpose in life at all, he didn't address that. Well, he actually agreed with me. He said that something like he's just an atheist flesh machine. So that goes on my side of the argument. On near-death experiences, he didn't really talk about that. He kind of says things like his opinion, but he doesn't give any arguments for it. On the body-mind dualism, he didn't give any arguments against that. He just said he disagrees with it. All those 15 arguments go on my side of the debate. On the topic of how atheists claim it's possible for God to exist or impossible, listen, guys, listen closely. He said it is possible for the Christian God to exist. I'm saying it's impossible for atheism to be true. Therefore, that also goes on my side of the argument. On the archaeological proof of the Bible, he just said, oh, yeah, there is, but he didn't provide any. So it's obviously clear that atheism, or should I say, faithism, has totally lost this debate. I'm kind of disappointed. I thought Steve would actually bring some arguments to the debate. I mean, Steve, you had 2 or 3 days to think about it. Steve, hey, Aquidarius. Steve, I know you guys are recording this, and it's good that people see how stupid atheism is. You know what Rabbi Zacharias said? Listen to me, my atheist friends. Rabbi Zacharias said something, it's so true. He said, the atheists risk everything for the present and future on the basis of a belief that we're uncaused by any intelligent being, we just happen to be here. That one is willing to live and die in that belief is a very high price to pay for conjecture. And then, Steve, you would agree with Francis Thompson. He says an atheist is a man who believes himself an accident. And then Joseph Addison says, and then I'll leave it with this, he says, to be an atheist requires an indefinitely greater measure of faith, that's your faithism, Steve, than to receive all the great truths which atheism would deny. Now, we're going to open up the thing because I know you're going to have open question stuff, but I want to tell you guys something because this is very important. A lot of people, and I used to be in the humanist religion of atheism, but you know what? Sometimes you decide, you know what, the lack of proof and evidence for atheism, I got to leave it. All right, hold on, Jesus Doctor. I know you want to hop on. But listen to this, guys. I want you to listen what Dr. William Lane Craig says on the topic of morality and why will some people be saved and why do people reject God. Listen closely. This really says it best. And by the way, Steve, my mom's going to be really hurt. Maybe you can get on the mic later and say something kind. Craig says, listen to this, guys. He says, quote, I find that contemporary atheists take great umbrage at the biblical claim that God does hold people to be morally culpable for their unbelief. He says they want to maintain their unbelief in God without accepting the responsibility for it. Unbelief is a choice. He says it is a choice to resist the force of the evidence and the drawing of God's Holy Spirit. You guys saw that all the evidence was on the side of Christian theism. Steve didn't produce any argument. He says the unbeliever is like someone dying of a fatal disease who refuses to believe the medical evidence concerning the efficacy of a preferred cure and who rejects the testimony of his doctor to it and who, as a result, suffers the consequences of his own stubbornness. He has no one to blame but himself. Now, I know you guys want to get on the mic and start asking questions, so here's what we want to do. If you guys want the mic...
Okay, guys. This is for... I'm just trying to ignore that. I'm not trying to, you know, ad hominem Steve or anything like that. I'd like to, you know, engage the arguments. First of all, I think it's important to note that nowhere during this argument has Steve address the ontological argument. That argument was completely avoided. Indeed, Steve himself conceded during the debate that it's possible that God exists, and given the ontological argument, if he grants that first premise, then it follows that God exists. So, given the debate format, Steve actually implicitly conceded that God exists. Even though he might not believe that in the debate format, he actually conceded defeat.